Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful that we can come into your house, that we can lift our hearts, lift our hands, God, and worship you, honor you, God. What a joy it is, God, to participate in the church service through giving, God, and as well, Lord, to just be here today, Lord, to hear your word, God. We don't want to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine, God. We came to hear from you. Be welcome in this place, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing for ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, they're our brothers and sisters, and we ask that you would bless them and be amongst them as you would be amongst us, God. And Lord, we praise you and thank you for it. God, also, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. Lord, we ask that you would comfort them, protect them, heal them, bless them, God, encourage them and strengthen them. Lord, may they endure to the end, to the glory of God. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say,
amen.
Amen. Well, today we are wrapping up the marriage series. This is part number 4 of the marriage series. Turn with me once again to the Song of Solomon. And this time we're going to be in chapter number 8. If you find the book of Isaiah, just come right back behind the book of Isaiah. You'll find Song of Solomon, chapter number 8. We're going to be taking a look at a couple of verses. Anybody enjoyed the marriage series so far? And I know it's been good for us. We've enjoyed it as well and just been neat. Had a lot of single. Any single people enjoyed the marriage series? All right, cool, cool. We're trying not to leave you guys behind. You know what I mean? You guys are awesome. Song of Solomon chapter 8. We're going to take a look at verse number 6 and verse number 7. Just a side note, you know, the Bible does say, and this one's for the single people, the Bible does say in Song of Solomon, you'll read it multiple times, don't awaken love before it's time. And that's a good encouragement for all of us that, you know what, God has the right time, the right sin. You just be patient, you wait on the Lord, and God will bring the right person along in the right way, and it will be wonderful. Song of Solomon chapter 8, verse number 6 and 7 says this. It says, set me as a seal upon your heart and as a seal upon your arm. For love is as strong as death. Jealousy is cruel as the grave. Its flames are flames of fire, a most vehement flame. Now, this reads like a Shakespearean poem, doesn't it? I mean, it's beautiful when you read it. And really, the Song of Solomon is a love song. It is God singing a love song to each and every one of us. And you'll notice as you read through the Song of Solomon that you'll find that there are some characters. There's the husband and wife. They're called the beloved is the husband. And this is the Shulamite or the wife speaking to the husband. And it's almost as if we're saying to God, God, I just want to be close to you. God, I want to be near to your heart. God, I want to be there on your arm. See, love is not only just an emotion, even though there are some feelings that come with love. You might get the butterflies, you might get all that kind of stuff, the warm fuzzies, whatever it is. But love is more than that. Love is an action. Love is a verb. Love is something that we do. Love is a, and when you look at it in the terms of marriage, it is a covenant. That's a binding agreement. It's the closest, most sacred and solemn of all contracts. And that's why it's saying, bind me as a seal. See, the covenant had to be sealed, and it was sealed with blood oftentimes. And our covenant with the Lord is sealed with the blood of Jesus. And so now we are sealed on the very heart of God. And it's an inward thing that takes place on the inside of us when we give our hearts and lives to Jesus. Now we are sealed with the blood of the Lord. Wall to wall, Holy Spirit. Now Jesus comes and lives on the inside of us. But also, set me as a seal on your arm. See, it's also something outwardly that people can see on us. They know that we love God because of how we act and how we live. And it goes on and it says, for love is as strong as death. You know, that's true when you take a look at it. God didn't even flinch in the face of death. Here Jesus, God in the flesh, comes. And he says, even though, Lord, I know there's pain and suffering ahead of me, not my will, but yours be done. Greater love has no man than this, than he would lay down his life for his friends. See, Jesus could have stayed in heaven. He could have just stayed there in the glory of God, enjoying the privileges he had in the Godhead. And yet he disrobed himself of his glory. He stepped down out of heaven and eternity into time and creation. And he laid down his life for each and every one of us for love. But his love was so strong that it overcame death. And it overcame the grave. It goes on and it says, jealousy is cruel or as strong as the grave. See, God was so jealous over us that he didn't want us betrothed to another. He came after us. Can you imagine? God loves you so much that he didn't want to live without you. So he died for each and every one of us individually. And it says that its flames are flames of fire, a most vehement flame. See, love will consume you. Love will take over. Love will completely envelop you. And that last term, a most vehement flame, really is a poetic form. If you look at it in the literal translation, it says it is a flame of Yah, or a flame of Yahweh, God Almighty. That love, true and pure love, comes from God's heart himself. And our God is a consuming fire. And as his love gets a hold of our heart now, and as his love comes on the inside of us now, it just consumes us. See, if you want to have a great marriage, you want to have a great life, you need to allow the love of God to come on the inside of you and to pour into every area of your life, to come out of you towards your spouse, towards others, towards the lost, and you will be fueled by the flame of God's love. It goes on in verse number 7, it says, many waters cannot quench love, nor can the floods drown it. Don't you know the devil would love to do everything he can to stop marriages? The devil would love to split up husbands and wives. Why? Because it's a picture of Christ and the church, and he hates God and he hates Christ. Therefore, he wants to get rid of every image of God on the earth. That's why he's trying to destroy marriages. That's why he's coming after it every way he can. And yet, the flood of dissipation, the flood of sexual immorality, the floods of waves of doctrine that have come through the church about love and about marriage and all that kind of stuff, those floods cannot quench the love of God.
Amen.
It says, if a man would give for love all the wealth of his house, it would be utterly despised. See, if you told me I had to choose between everything that I own, all of my property, even raise the stakes, give me the whole world, but I'd have to give up my wife? Nope, not going to happen. Me and her, we'll go live in a cardboard shack somewhere. Go find a bridge. And it was no different with God for us. God gave up everything, put it all on the line for love for us. In our marriages, in our lives, we need to keep the love of God centrally focused, and it will create a strong bond that cannot be quenched by the floods around us. Today, we're going to be talking to the men about a couple more things. Ephesians chapter 5, you want to turn there with me. Ephesians chapter number 5. We've been in Ephesians chapter 5 talking about the commandments to the husband and the commandments to the wife. Kind of towards the end of chapter 5, you'll find that the Apostle Paul starts to write about marriage. Starts to talk. He's inspired by the Holy Spirit, talking about Christ in the church. And we're going to wrap up our thoughts today in the commandments to the men. And we find them both in one verse, Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 31. And it says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother. Remember, we talked about that, gentlemen. We need to leave the past behind, leaving the ways of our parents, not just leaving our parents physically. You know, you still can be in relationship with them or live close to them, but really starting our own traditions and starting our own new ways as a family based on the will and the way of the Lord. And it says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So we see that there's a commandment here that we are to leave and to be joined to our wife, and the two shall become one. See, marriage is about unity. Marriage is about oneness. Now, like Pastor Jim, you just heard him during the announcement say, that's me over there, and I'm her. And for us, this is us now. It's no longer two me's, it's one we, right? The two have become one, and it's about unity. Therefore, the commandment to the men is this, is to think, operate, and live as one. Think, operate, and live as one. Now, some of you gentlemen might be scratching your head and saying, well, wait a second, hold on, because we've been having some disagreements and we have never agreed on these things. You know, we just can't get together. Well, you got to start thinking like each other. You got to start changing the way you think. You know how you do that? You start to renew your mind according to the Word of God. Start to get this on the inside of you. And then in order to think together, it's not going to happen by osmosis. Come on, somebody. There is no digital download for the way the woman thinks. You're going to have to talk it out. Oh, my, my, my. For some of you who are saying, you know, communication is important in marriage, I wonder when they're going to talk about communication in marriage. Today is that day. We are talking about talking. Hello. Gentlemen, that means you're going to have to open your mouth and use your words. It's just the way it is. I know, guys. We don't like that. We want to come home. We want to kick our feet up. How was your day? Good. Honey, you don't look so good. Are you feeling all right? Yeah. Listen, I do it. But we're going to have to communicate. If you want to operate and eventually live as one, see, that's the goal, is that we're to live as one. But in order to do that, you're going to have to communicate. Here's the easy way when talking about communication. Just sing the love song, right? You remember this one? Hello from the other side. That's what the wife is saying right there. Right? She's going, come on, hello, let's talk. Pick up the phone, call me, come see me, take me out on a date. Let's communicate about this, right? And so we all need to understand this is a process. It's almost like squares, right? I got some tile squares up here. And here's number one is to think as one. So in order for us to think as one, we got to talk things out. You got to start to talk it out. Then as you talk it out, then you start to walk it out, right? You start to operate in it. You start to see if it's working. And if it's working, eventually you will start to live as one, right? That's the process. But if you start to think as one and you think something's okay and you start to talk about it, we're going to do things like this way, and then you start to operate as one and it doesn't work out, then you will not get to square three, right? Because it's not working. So what do you got to do? You got to go back to square one. You got to start talking about it again. Wait, that wasn't working. Let me give you an example that happened to myself and my wife this week. This past Thursday morning, my wife was preaching at Girlfriends AM, now called Women Rock. We got to change our terminology. And so she was getting ready to come, and they were doing a prayer series. And so she was going to preach on prayer, and then they were going to pray and all this kind of stuff. And so she's getting ready in the morning. Now, the weather change just messed me up. Anybody else, you know, getting that sinus junk after the weather change? I hate that. You know, it's like all of a sudden it's dead winter. It's 80 degrees outside. All the trees think it's spring, and I've got sinus junk, you know. So I'm having trouble sleeping, and I'm coughing and hacking and all that kind of stuff. So I'm waking up Thursday morning, and you know, I'm not at 100%. And already, mornings are not my time. I'm not peak time in the morning. I am peak time at night, right? My mind is going. I've got ideas. Creativity's flowing, all that kind of stuff. So she wakes up, and her peak time is early, right? So she comes in, and she's like, honey, will you help me and the kids get ready and get out? Now, that's what she said, okay? What I heard was get the kids ready and take them to school. Right? Completely different, yeah. So we're thinking differently. And we start to operate differently. So I go jump in the shower. I'm getting ready. You know, I'm getting my clothes on, all that kind of stuff. Kids are coming to the door. I'm saying, okay, you get the lunches. You take care of this. A little coaster broke. And so I'm going, you go clean it up. Now that was not acceptable to my lovely wife.
Well, first of all, it wasn't just a coaster. It was a glass coaster.
Yeah, it was glass.
Which is a big deal with little kids. Not a big deal. So, yes. And the whole time I am wondering, why is he getting ready at all?
Well, because this he's is my to be part of the sermon. Stay out of my sermon right now. Come on. I'll give you your time.
We're one. This is our sermon.
My goodness.
Good point,
babe.
Okay,
moving on. So I'm getting ready, and finally she says, what are you doing? And I said, I'm doing what you said for me to do, which was get ready and get the kids out the door to school. She said, no. I said, to get me and the kids ready and get us out to school and church.
Which means make sure Titus doesn't have a crazy outfit on before he leaves the house.
He
because
was fine.
He always does.
He's fine.
And make sure we have food. The kids have food in their belly so I could get dressed, ready, pray, get the Spirit
They were
of
fed.
God.
They were fine. They had lunches. You know, my little five-year-old did most of the work anyway, so it was good.
Yeah.
It all worked out. The kid's sharp,
man.
He had
to come back in and change, by the way.
What's wrong with a thermal? You know, I mean, 82 degrees outside wearing a thermal shirt, so... Nothing wrong with that. Right, dads?
Yeah.
Amen. There you go. Don't hold back. Don't say it too loud. Okay. So we had to go back to the drawing board. We had to figure things out. So then Friday morning rolls around, and I wake up, and she says, will you take the kids to school? And I said, stop. You want me to get ready and actually drive the kids in the car. You want my person to be the one behind the wheel and driving the car to church to drop the kids off at school. She said,
yes.
Yes, yes. And so that's what we did. See, if it's not working, you got to go back to square one. See, disagreements will take place. But you cannot operate in a marriage in disagreements. Amos chapter 3, verse number 3. How can two people even walk together in a straight line unless they are agreed? You got to have agreement. There's power in agreement in your marriage. You need to say, this is the way that we're going. And that takes time. It takes talking things out. It takes working things out. And then finally, you'll live as one. You know, everybody wants to be that old married couple that's been married for decades, that can complete each other's sentences, and that when they're across a room in a crowded room full of people with all sorts of noise going on, can look at each other and just know what each other are thinking. We all want that. But that doesn't happen just because you got married. That happens because you started to talk, then you started to operate in it, and then you operated in it so long that you started to live it out as one. See, because these little disagreements can split up marriages. Here's one. For those of you, maybe you're dating, maybe you're engaged in this place, you need to have these talks before you get married. Like, are we going to squeeze the toothpaste from the middle? Or are we going to roll it up from the back? Very important for your marriage. How about this one? Does the toilet paper go down the front? Or does it go up against the wall down the back? Because the kids will do this, or the dog, or whatever, you know? These things, it's the little foxes that spoil the vine. These things turn into big things, and big things all of a sudden blow up over time. And so you have to communicate. You got to think, you got to operate, and you've got to live as one. Second thing that we see, Ephesians chapter 5, if you will, in verse... Oh, before I go there, let me just say this, okay? This can change over time. Change over seasons of life. As you hit a new season, you're going to have to go back to square number one, okay? And some of you guys know this because my wife and I operated a certain way, but then when we had children, it was like somebody just threw a wrench into the works and we had to go back to square one. Okay, wait a second. How are we doing sleep? Okay, you take first watch, right? Since you're the night owl. I'll be up, I'll be the sentinel at night, right? And since you're the early bird, I'll go to bed about 2 a.m., and then you take the morning watch, and I'll get some sleep in the morning, right? So we had to go back to the drawing board. How we did finances before children is not how we're doing finances after children. Yep. Hello.
Amen.
And then how about this one? When the kids move out, some of you guys have experienced this. All of a sudden, you're empty nesters, and you look across the room at each other, and you say, hi, who are you? How long have you been here, right? You got to go back to square number one. Wait a second. Who are we without our children? It changes over time. Retirement is a new season of life. And you know, there's different things. You know, if you move into a new area or you start doing something new, some of you guys just got saved and you've been married before and now you're saved and you're saying, how do we do this? You're going to have to communicate and it changes over time. All right, now we can move on. Needed to say that. I thought it was important. Second thing is this, Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 31. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife. In Matthew, Jesus quotes this verse, and in the Old King James Version, it says that we should leave and cleave. All right, I like that because it rhymes. Leave and cleave. And so the commandment for the men, last thing that we're going to talk about, and I like this one, is enjoy cleaving to your wife. I should have had a hearty, healthy, manly amen on that one. Cleaving means to cling faithfully. Now, this is not just talking about sex, okay, ladies? So don't worry. We're not just talking about sex. But, gentlemen, it does include sex. All right? Now, for some of the parents in the family rooms, you got your little kids there, you might just want to cover the ears. It's going to go PG-13. We won't get too bad, all right? But we need to talk about the physical relationship because it's important in marriage. Cleaving to your wife means that, you know, that you enjoy the physical aspect. God made her beautiful. You know, when the Bible says he formed man, he said he was good. But when he fashioned and formed the woman, it says that he said she was very good. See, she's beautiful because men are visually stimulated, and therefore God made women beautiful. So, men, you got to enjoy your wife. Enjoy the smell of her hair. Enjoy the softness of her touch. Enjoy the things. Enjoy the beauty and the femininity because God made her that way. And God created men to be rugged and tough and all that kind of stuff, but he made women beautiful and soft and just warm and inviting, and they smell good, you know, and men, we have a hard time smelling good sometimes, you know, and that's okay. So enjoy that physical aspect. You need to enjoy the intimacy that comes with marriage. That is a privilege that is to be enjoyed inside of marriage, okay? God said that there is a covenant now, and that is something that is to be enjoyed inside of marriage. So single people, no.
Amen.
Okay? Just remember that, no. But for the married people, we got a license, okay? License to thrill. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse number 2, in the New Living Translations, I'll put it up on the overhead for you. It says, but because there is so much sexual immorality. How many of you know there's a lot of sexual immorality out there in the world? People are living together. They're jumping in the sack before marriage. This is not how it should be. That's called fornication. And then there's people that are married that are swinging. They're going out with other people's wives or husbands. That's called adultery.
That'll send you to hell.
And the Bible says it. And you know what? Someone please just tell us the truth of God's word. It will send you to hell. You can find it all throughout the Bible. It will say, the book of Proverbs says that the adulteress's steps lead down to hell.
Yep.
So if you're doing that, it's time to repent, okay, and stop it. Okay? Now you say, I can't stop it, then get married, okay? Because now you're in covenant, all right? So that's not a reason to get married, but listen, it says better to marry than to burn, okay? So if you know we're going to get married someday, then you might as well get married, all right? We'll get you connected. We'll get you married, all right? Call the church offices, dial 0, and talk to the receptionist. We want to get married, okay? You don't have to give any details. But because there is so much sexual immorality, and the devil has perverted sex. The devil has made it out to be something that it's not. I mean, I need to burst some bubbles. I'm sorry about this, single people, but sex is not like you see in the movies. You know, your wedding night, you will find this out. Oftentimes, the wedding night is described as painful and awkward, okay? Not like steamy and romantic and everything that I thought it would be and hours of fun and all that. No, it was the worst 15 minutes of our priest starting marriage. You know, that's usually what I hear.
Shh.
What? We got to tell the truth.
15 years is good now.
Hey, 15 years. We've had a lot of practice, and so it's getting better all the time. But, I mean, that's the thing. And so it says, because there's so much sexual immorality, there's a lot of wrong thinking about sex. There's a lot of abuse with sex. And if you've had those experiences in your life, my goodness, allow the love of the Father to just cleanse you of those things and to wash those things off of you. My goodness, go get free. Go into breaking free or you know, do what you need to do. Get with the Father and allow the love of God to just pour over you. Repent of the sin. And, you know, if you have been abused, then allow the love of God to renew you and make you a new creation. And you can start fresh. And now, hey, because there's so much sexual immorality, listen, I'm not going to. The book of 1 Thessalonians says, possess your own vessel. Don't go trying to possess somebody else's vessel. Possess your own vessel in purity and holiness, fleeing youthful lust. Run away from that stuff. Gentlemen, get away from pornography. I don't care if you have to throw your smartphone away and get a dumb phone. I don't care if you have to get rid of the internet access or the television channels that are dragging you down. It is a tar pit.
Amen.
My goodness.
Women too. It's not just
hey,
men.
Ladies and gentlemen these days, yeah. Listen, I was exposed to pornography at age 10. That's shocking. That should not be. And yet in our society, there is so much sexual immorality. And listen, we ought to be talking about this stuff in church.
Yeah.
We ought to be making sure people know this is not right. What's right is you get married, then you have sex. Because that's the way it's been meant to be enjoyed by God. Now look at what the rest of the verse says. My goodness, we didn't even get past the first part of the verse. Look at this. Each man should have his own wife, and each woman should have her own husband. You got chapter and verse, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, you have a license from the Word of God to enjoy the physical aspect of your marriage. Now, I wanted to just show some things real quick, just enjoying the physical aspects of your wife while we listen to the smooth voice of Dave Barnes. I just wanted to just show you this. Come here, my love. Come here, my love. This is just enjoying the physical aspect of your wife. This is what it's all about right here. Just loving her, holding her. Bringing her close. You know, sometimes you sit on the couch and she's way over there. Gentlemen, okay, you do the hop, right? And then, right? And bring her in, okay?
For him, for you, it's
Max, get off her.
Yeah, kids, yeah, get the dog, away. Get the kids, kick the kids off, right, all that kind of stuff. Hold her hand, right, love on her, and keep her close. This is enjoying being united to your wife. I love you, honey.
I love you, too. This is not lipstick that won't come off. So okay, well, air kiss.
Mwah, we'll kiss later.
Okay. Hi, is it my turn?
It's your turn.
Okay,
you
wait,
it.
Before you sit down, I need to fix something.
What do you need to fix, honey?
Well, maybe you could come help me. What because that's what husbands do. They help their wives when they need something. So the women today, we're talking about keeping our homes.
What all do you have back
so
there?
So I thought we could just do a little do up here because it's a little boring. And so maybe we could just add some pillows
it's
to the
table. It's fine.
No, I think it needs a little bit more.
What is all this stuff?
Well, we're talking about making things beautiful today. And so if you could just put that right here, honey, on the floor because I don't want to mess up my groove. Okay,
right
thank you. Yes.
You want these flowers?
Yes, thank you. These are the flowers he gave me when he said he was sorry for fighting on Thursday.
Here's our kids.
And this is a picture of our beautiful children.
What are we doing with this?
And a candle, because everything is much better with candle. You could put that away. Hide it so nobody sees it.
Hide it?
Yeah, because you don't want anyone to see your mess.
Okay.
Okay, now Missy, you got to like lower the lights for me a bit, because everybody looks better in the dark. There you go, mood lighting. Isn't that much better, honey? Now settle in, make yourself at home, and us girls are gonna talk.
I'm gonna
okay?
take a nap.
No, don't take a nap, because you need to hear this. Okay, hi girls. Hello, gentlemen. How are you? Ooh, I like that, that was quite manly.
Hello.
So, okay, we're on commandment number four. That was like, wow. Commandment number four. And girls, we're not going to go to Ephesians this time. We're going to go to Titus. And the commandment number four is, wives, love your husbands by keeping your homes. You're going, oh, man, she's going to talk about cooking and cleaning and taking care of my house. I am. You know why I am? Because God talks about it. And because it's important to God, and so it needs to become important to us as women. I know our society today, we're busy, we've got a lot of things to do, but I believe that there are ways to do it and to do it beautifully. Look it, you can light a candle, you can go to the dollar store, you could get a candle, and it can change the whole atmosphere of the house. If you're up here right now, it smells heavenly, doesn't it?
It smells great.
Like a spa. So anyways, that's just for you, babe. So later on, you can bring it home. Okay, now the husband is the head of the house. But the woman is the heart of the home. And in Titus 2:3-6, it says, the older women likewise, that they be reverent in behavior, not slanderous, not given to much wine, so I guess they can have some, teachers of good things. That's the way I read that.
Don't get drunk.
So when I get older, I'll have some, I guess. Okay, just kidding, I just want to play. Okay, teachers of good things. So now let's stop there for a second. You're an older lady, and guess what's happening? You're being watched. Us younger girls, we are checking you out. We are watching how you treat your husbands. We're watching what comes out of your mouth. We're watching how you keep your homes. We're watching what it is that you do. And a wise young woman will go to an older woman and say, how did you do this? How did you get through this? Like, I am frustrated right now with my home or my husband, or I don't understand how to do the bills. And you can go and you can meet up with someone who's already been there. And so that is a beautiful picture of what God wants. He says, let the older women teach the younger women. And that's what he's referring to in this scripture. Then it goes on and it's talking to the younger women now, that they may admonish the women to love their husbands. We already talked about loving our husbands earlier, to love their children. So you have to love your children, okay, even when they bug you. And verse number 5, to be discreet, to be chaste, to be homemakers, good, obedient to their husbands, to the word of God, that they may not be blasphemed. I love in the message that it says, to keep a good house, to be good wives. We don't want anyone looking down on God's message because of our behavior. Listen, we're being watched. I have a little girl, her name is Chloe, and Chloe is 11 years old last week, and I know that Chloe is watching everything I do. She's watching the way I talk to Daddy. She will pick up on those mannerisms, because I notice when I'm a little bossy, she becomes kind of bossy with her brothers, and they're like, seriously right now, what are you doing? And I have to say, oh, Chloe, I'm sorry. I've just been on go mode, and I'm just spouting orders, so forgive me. Please don't be like that with your brothers, because you're not going to get anywhere with them. And so you have to teach the girls how to do life, because they're watching you. I had the best example of a woman in my life. My mom is the ultimate mom and wife. She really is. When we were little, if we had no money, I never knew. Because everywhere we lived, every house we lived in, it was special. She made it a home. She did the curtains up. She had pillows, special pillows. My mom sewed everything, which I really wish I could do that. I just ask her to do it now for me. But, you know, she sewed everything. She made it so special. I never felt unloved. I felt like I was just so in love with my mom and dad were so in love with each other. And the home reflected that for me. I would come home, and there would be dinner, and I could smell the food, and it was like, what are you making for dinner today? I remember waking up in the morning, and my mom would have breakfast with all of us, and she would make breakfast for us. You know, it's what we do that creates that atmosphere, ladies. We are in control of that. You know, happy wife, happy life, sure. But you know, mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. That's true as well. Listen, women, we're in control of our attitudes and the way that we present ourselves as women of the Most High God. And that means you need to put a smile on our faces. That means we got to get past what we want, what our desires are. You think I want to be up in the middle of the night 50 times with the kids? No. But you know what? I love them so much. I would do anything for them. And you know, when Dan needs something, I will drop everything and run to, what is it you need? What do you need me to do for you? How can I help you? Because I want to be that wife that creates a beautiful atmosphere for my family in our home and outside of our home. And I carry that everywhere I go. And so I just have a couple tips for us as women. Number one, women, just so you guys know, women are a couple of things. So men, listen up, okay? And girls, you can say amen. We are, number one, relationship driven. We love the relationships in our lives. It's what moves us. It's what motivates us. It's what we're tapped into. I can feel my kids. I know when the kids are about to wake up, I'm standing there before they do. It's like the weirdest thing. And I don't know what that is, mother's intuition. I don't know. But I'm just always in tune with what's going on. While around the church, I can feel you. Sometimes you're having a hard day, and you aren't going to say anything. And if I walk by, I'm like, are you okay? Is everything all right? Talk to me. How are you feeling? See, women just have that. Okay, so we love the relationships in our lives, but we're also driven by both sides. We're driven by both sides of our brain, and they work together. You go, yeah, that's weird. It is kind of weird. We can laugh and cry at the exact same time and totally feel both of those emotions. And you know what? We're incredible multitaskers. I'm telling you, I could be cooking dinner, talking to my best friend on the phone. I could be texting the office about what needs to happen at Women Rock the next day, help Micah with his homework, and kiss Dan as he walks in the door. And I'm telling you, it all gets done, and I don't even think twice about it, because women can multitask on a level that we just do it because we have to do it. And I believe that's because both sides of our brain work. I know that may seem crazy to the men, but listen, if it weren't for us being that way, you would be dead. Because we take care of it. We got your back behind the scenes. Okay, she is far more sensitive to sight. You know, women will notice things before men usually do. Oh, something's not right over there. Oh, that's ugly. Let me fix that. Let me adjust that. How many of you live with women that move furniture all the time in your house? Every time I go to my mom's
all
house,
the strong
we're moving
guys.
Furniture. That's because she's sensitive to sight. She knows that, oh, my eye's not landing there. I need to fix that. Smell and beauty is something we're attracted to. My husband cannot walk into Bath and Body Works. He just starts sneezing like crazy. He's just like, go in yourself. I don't want anything to do with that because it's just too much for him. But I love it. I walk in, I'm like, oh, let me smell this and let me touch this. What's the textures of that? And you know, women are sensitive to those things. We create those things. We put them all together and we make something beautiful out of it. And I believe that's what God asked us to do. So girls, embrace it because it's a gift from God. It's something he put inside of us. Tips on making our home special. You ready? Bring beauty into your home with sight, smell, and touch. Be willing to shop for deals. Yes, you heard me right. You have permission to shop for deals. Now you go, what does that mean? Listen, when I am shopping and I know I need something for my house, do you know what I do first? I pray. First, I ask God for a really good parking spot, and I always get one. And number two, I always find really good deals. Like, I really, really do. Everywhere I go, it's like God just leads me where I need to go, and I find really great deals. When you have the Holy Spirit on your side, you can find exactly what you're looking for at the price you need it, because he's got your back, girls, and we are the ones that go out and we find things and we bring it home, right? That's our job. In Proverbs 31, it says, she is like a trading ship that sails far away places and brings back exotic surprises. To me, this in the Word of God gives me permission to shop.
I'm not getting it.
We're one. So we are shopping together. Okay. Ready? Number two. We work hard for our families. It doesn't just happen. You just don't get dinner all of a sudden on your table unless we drove to Chipotle and we got you your burrito and we put it on a plate. No. It takes time to plan a meal. It takes time to go to the grocery store, and then you got to go to another grocery store, and it takes time to cook it. Then it takes time to clean it. Then it takes time to whatever else we're doing. You know, you got to set up the table. You got to tear down the table. I mean, there are things. Girls, we got to help with homework. We have schedules to put together. See, Dan doesn't realize, but in my mind, I am scheduling out our week.
I'm so painfully aware.
Today, yes, painfully aware. So today I need you to take the kids because I have five other things I'm doing, but I'm going to take the kids today so you can just chill and relax and take it slow this morning because I know you don't feel good. I mean, I schedule that in. That's what was on my mind. It was actually to benefit Pastor Dan that day, and it did not turn out that way. But we schedule things. We do homework. We do, you know, we have to counsel our children. Hello, you need to get in your kids' face. You need to find out what's going on in their world. We have family traditions, and a lot of times, my daughter's not one that will just, like, offer information because I think she just doesn't care. Like, I don't know. She's very, like, not normal. Like, she just, oh, did that happen? Okay. Nothing bothers her. Nothing. But my son, Micah, will tell me everything. Listen, this happened, and I can't believe that. And why would that happen? And did it? And I never have to pull anything out of him. But I have to sit down with Chloe, and I have to get in her. Chloe, how's your day today? What's going on? Is everybody getting along in your class? And what are you feeling? And how are things happening in your world? And because you know why? Because I got to keep open lines of communication because I don't want the devil to come in and mess with her thoughts. And I got to keep the atmosphere of my home all put together on a godly level. And I got to get in my children's business. And guess what? You don't get to keep a diary that I don't get to read. So it's in my house, and I'm going to read it. You see, women, you are the teacher, you're the nurse, you're the cook, you're the lover at the end of the night, and you know what else? You're the secret spy agent to your children. And so you do what you need to do, and you take control of what needs to be taken control of, because that's our spot. We're in there. We are the ones like stealth mom doing what we need to do, seeing what needs to happen. You know, last night the devil tried to come in our home and mess with me, and I was up in the middle of the night like, no, in the name of Jesus, you're not coming in this house. You can go back to hell where you came from. You're not going to give my kids bad dreams. I'm not going to have bad dreams. I'm pacing the halls. I'm tearing heaven down. I'm like, heaven lives here. You've got to go, devil. And you see, I am not going to let hell even come near my doorstep. But that means I'm on watch, and I'm taking care of my household, and I'm doing what God's asked me to do. Now that means love my husbands, love my children, and serve God and push them into the kingdom. If I have to kick their butts all the way up to heaven, I will. Because one day they will thank you. One day they will thank us. So it takes hard work. It takes hard work to do that. And you've got it. You're anointed and you're appointed to do the hard work because God has given us a grace to do what it is he's asked us to do. Number three, make your own family traditions. You know, I know that we have a big extended family, and we have family traditions on both of our sides. My family loves to sing the happy birthday song. We have your special person. We make up our own song. Half of you probably know the song because you've now been joined into our family. And it's a beautiful tradition. We do a lot of things. We go on a family vacation in the summertime. You know, the first few days we fight, then we love each other the rest of them. It's a really fun time. And we do family traditions, but then we also have had to learn how to make some traditions on our own with our own intimate, you know, family. So I started one at Christmas that Dan absolutely hated. Hated. We were married. We had no children. We were at Rhema Bible Training Center, and we had no money. But I got a free gingerbread kit from the store I was working at. And I said, we're going to put it together. This will be our new tradition. And he's like, why? This is dumb. Why would we do this? We don't even have kids. And I'm like, because I want to do it. I mean, he really hurt my feelings. And when he found out he hurt my feelings, he complied and we did it, right? And then every year after that, we've done it. And we've done it with the children. And now they push us to do it. And now it's actually fun. And this year, I was so tired because we had 4 Christmas trees in our house this year. I went a little overboard. And I was exhausted. So Dan had to do the gingerbread house with the kids. And so, but now he loves it because he is actually the one that makes the icing and they create awesome things. Yeah, he's the general contractor. And so we've made our own tradition in that way. We also do, we do dinner together or we do breakfast together. Whatever time of the day, make time to put your family together and be together. That season may change for you. For me, when we were teenagers, my mom said, okay, you all are gone at night, so in the morning I'm going to do breakfast. And we got up every morning, had breakfast together. But when we were kids, we had dinner together every evening. And so we have dinner together, and when we sit there with our kids, we make sure they have all the electronics are turned off. No TVs, no phones, and listen, Daddy doesn't get a phone either, and he doesn't get a TV. So what you ask your children to do, you need to do as well. You need to look them in the eyes, you need to engage in conversation, and this is what I do. I look at my kids and I say, what were the highs of your day? Let's talk about your highs. And they start telling me about the good things during the day. And then I ask them about the low things of their day. And you know what happens? It opens up great conversation for me and Dan to get in there with the Word of God and say, okay, so maybe that didn't go the way it should have. What would you change about that? What does the Word of God say about that? And it begins to open up dialogue amongst actually all 3 of them end up giving each other advice now. And it's actually a very cool conversation. So do what it is you need to do. Make your own family traditions. In Proverbs 31:26, it says, when she speaks, her words are wise, and she gives instruction with kindness. She carefully watches everything in her household and suffers nothing of laziness. Listen, ladies, I don't want my husband to go, oh, she's not kind, she's mean, she's always crabby, she's always bossy. I want my children and my husband to go, no, she was kind, and she loved us. And when she got stern, it was because she needed to get stern, because we weren't doing what it was that we needed to do. But my mom loved us, and she honored us, and she took care of us. And I truly can say that about you, Mom. You have been that for me. So thank you for being the best mom in the whole entire world and watching her be the best wife as well. And I'm going to end with this verse. Proverbs 31:28 says, her children stand, and they bless her. Her husband praises her. Listen, women, we have an incredible job to keep our homes, make it a beautiful sanctuary for our family to come, and feel the presence of Jesus as they walk through the door. Light a candle, give them a kiss, give them their schedules, be the sex goddess at night and the super spy agent during the day. But God has got your back. He's anointed and he's appointed you to be able to do what it is he's asked us to do. I love you. Happy Valentine's Day.
That was fantastic. Before you run off, I just want to take a moment. If you're married in this place, just grab your spouse's hand if they're with you. If not, just hold a hand up to heaven, and let's just pray for marriages. I'm going to pray for the married people. Would you pray for the single people?
Yes.
Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for this series that we have come through together, God. We thank you, Lord, for your wisdom, God. And I ask, Lord, that you bless the marriages in this place. God, I pray, Lord, that husbands would take their place as the head of the home, and wives would come under that mission, God, and submit to their own husbands, Lord. That you would just bring unity, God, that you would bring forgiveness and love, Lord, that they'd be able to think, operate, and live as one and enjoy their marriage, God. Enjoy being united as one, God. And we praise you and thank you for it in Jesus' name.
And dear God, I lift up the single people in this room. And Lord, I pray that this coming year, Lord, that you would bless them, that the men would find wonderful wives, Lord, godly women, women that will serve you and be righteous before you, God. And Lord, I pray that there would be incredible unions in your name. And those that are single, God, that don't want to get married, I pray that you bless them, that you'd fill every void, that you would just cherish every step that they take, God, that you would guide them down paths that are just amazing. Lord, use their hands and their feet to be your gospel, to shout your name, to make your name famous. And Lord, I pray for blessing upon them. I pray for the joy of the Lord to be their strength. I pray that, God, that there would not be any void, but Lord, you would fill every void. Lord, that you'd meet every need. And Lord, that you would just be their husband or their, you know, their spouse in this season, God. And Lord, we love you so much. Thank you for covering us in our relationships. Thank you for loving us so deeply that you gave us your word, God, that would bring revelation to us and help us to be the men and women you've asked us to be, whether whether we're single or married. We love you, we honor you, and we adore you. Oh, our groom, and Lord, we are your bride. So here we are, your servants in your house. Thank you so much for what you've given us. You. Happy Valentine's Day, Jesus. We love you.
Love you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Love you, babe. What a great series it's been. It's been awesome. I want to just ask everybody, please remain seated at this time. Go ahead, have a seat, okay? A couple more minutes, I'll let you go. I want to make sure before you leave this place that your heart's right with God, that if you died, that you wouldn't go to hell, but that you would go to heaven. You know, sometimes people say, well, I don't have to worry about that because I don't believe hell is real. Or sometimes people say, well, but wait a second, don't all roads lead to heaven? But you know, the Bible talks about hell, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke of it. It's a very real place. And just because you say you don't believe in it doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to deal with the reality of it. And I know that you want to go to heaven. But not all roads lead to heaven. It's like me saying here on the earth, all roads lead to the moon. You would say, you're crazy. You could drive around the earth as long as you want and you'll never make it. In the same way, what makes us think we can do whatever we want to do to get to heaven? It doesn't work like that. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. There's one way you're going to get to heaven. Jesus said you must be born again. Now I know Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet have made that out to be something that it's not. They've raked it through the coals, made out some goofy, weirdo stuff that we all would say, well, I don't want to be that. If that's being born again, man, I don't like that. And yet, let's not let the world define for us what being born again means. Let's find out from the Bible what being born again means. So we can be born again, headed for heaven, and denying our presence in hell. Well, does it mean being good? No, because the Bible says the standard of getting into heaven on your own goodness is perfection. No one is perfect. You're not going to make it to heaven just by being good. Is it by attending church or volunteering in a church, helping out? No, it's not. You can sit in a church service, call yourself a Christian as long as you want. It'll never make you a Christian. That's like me saying, I want to go be a fish. And I go to the Pacific Ocean, sit in the water, call myself a fish. It doesn't work. Eventually, I'll just be a slimy, pruny human sitting there in the water. Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Well, does it mean that I know something about God or can quote some scripture? No. Do you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say because you know God that you get to go to heaven? Isn't that shocking? We would think, well, the people who know God, they get to go to heaven, right? But wrong. Because if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. If you'd read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head, not about mental ascent towards God, not about all the good you've done or all the church you've sat through, but rather this is about your heart. God's always been after your heart. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Those are pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, and occasional church attendance. And God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do just that. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life. Want to be born again, headed for heaven, deny my presence and all. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. But let's get over that embarrassment today. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than to stand up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for an eternity away from God? Come on. And yet, insecurity, your flesh, going to try and talk you out of it right now. Don't do it. You'll be embarrassed. Hey, come on. Don't worry about it. You're amongst friends and family today who love you. We want you to do this. We're excited for you. No one's criticizing, judging, or condemning you. The devil's going to try and talk you out of it, try and lie at you. You've been good enough. You're fine. This is just emotionalism. This is just fanaticism. No. It's not. Tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God today. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise your hand if you've never done this, never given God all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, I can see you guys. Ready to get your hands up if you need to. If you're here on campus in the foyer or down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the breakfast burrito down. Get ready to get your hand up. And then you can tell an usher right afterwards or come into the church service. Online, if you're watching via the live stream, wherever you're at all over the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees and God's watching you right where you're at. And then afterwards, you can minimize your video browser, click the blue button that says Know God, or go to our homepage, rockchurch.com, and find the tab on the right-hand side that says How to Know God. And someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. There's one, two, three, four. Got you over there. Thank you. There's four wise people already on this side. Where you at? Five over there. Thank you. Got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. Five. I got you right there. Thank you. Up on top. Six. Thank you. Over on this side. Over on this side. Anybody else real quick? Six. Anybody else back here? Six, seven, got you over there in the family room. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Seven, eight up there. Thank you. Thank you. We got eight wise people already. We're at number 9 and 10. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Let's go for God today. Jesus loves you so much. What a Valentine's Day gift to give to God. All of your heart and all of your life. If that's you in this place, come on, let's go for God. Will you give him exactly what he wants, which is all your heart and all of your life? Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? Raise it up high right now. If that's you, number 9, number 10, come on, raise it up high. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a hand for 8 wise people. Woo! All right, all 8 of you, number 9, number 10, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. Get all your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. If you're sitting next to somebody who raised their hand, or maybe you think they should have, just give them a little nudge, okay, out of love and respect, and just say, hey, if you need to go, I'll go with you right now. Because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that until we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. From the family rooms, bring your children down. They'll remember this. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
Come on. You raise your hand, or you should have. Just make your way to the front right now. They're coming. Let's give them a hand. You can come too. Come on, come on. If that's you, you need to come. Just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Anybody else? All right. Hey, thank God you guys came. You can put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. All right. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You just sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, you already got past me, okay? He's cool. He's going to do 3 things. First thing he's going to do, he's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature, help you find out what to do next in your walk with God, okay? Even for the youth, we've got some information too, a little comic book that'll help them remember what happened today, okay? And then finally, what he's going to do, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Now, I know that sounds terrible, doesn't it? It's a program, you know, but let me describe it to you like this. It's a friend. Someone in church will come alongside you and encourage you in the will and the way of the Lord. Okay, so you don't go back to your old ways that you're walking away from right now, but that you go on with God, serving the Lord throughout the rest of your days, okay? It's easy, it's free. He'll describe how it works, and then I'll let you come right back out, okay? So if you guys will just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.